The obsession with trying to improve ourselves and our appearances is not a recent thing, but it used to be maybe a little less superficial than it is now. I mean, the popularity of a show like The Biggest Loser is not just about looking at people's hips or, you know, how many pounds they've lost from one week to the next. I mean, if you think about it, and I don't mean to be overreaching here, but it is kind of a spiritual quest for these people, you know, to try to gain the self-control that's necessary to do what they do on that show. And I think the loss of self-control is one of the biggest themes of modern times when you think about it. I mean, we don't have the social forces that are in place anymore to help us in our quests, whether they are to become, you know, a better person or a thinner person or a more beautiful person. You know, we don't have the religious influences there. We don't have the societal pressures there. A lot of people, you know, sort of celebrate the way our culture kind of says anything goes. But for individual people, that may not necessarily be kind of the key to a long-term happiness. It may be that people actually do kind of want to improve themselves, but they need help along the way. And they're kind of looking for either outside experts to give them that kind of guidance, but also kind of a peer pressure to help them along toward their goals. I mean, you notice that, you know, on a show like The Biggest Loser, you know, the people are really encouraged, or they're in competition with the other people on the show. There's a dynamic there that probably wouldn't be as interesting to watch, but also would be much more difficult if this were just one individual trying to improve himself alone. One of the more popular kinds of shows out there now are not necessarily what we think of exactly as reality shows, but they're more like how-to shows. You know, whether it's people who are trying to improve the look of their house or people who are trying to improve the look of their clothes. And it's interesting how many people just flipping through the channels kind of stop on these shows. These are total strangers. They're not celebrities. They're not going to be, you know, in any tabloids tomorrow. And yet you're totally fascinated by how they're going to transform their kitchen or their wardrobe. And I'm definitely interested in why that's the case. I think that, you know, we all kind of are rooting for them in a sense. We want their kitchen to look great, and we want them to be able to improve the way they look. I mean, you know, if you think about kind of the clothing aspect of this on a show like What Not to Wear, you know, what you have is people who've been told by culture that you can wear whatever you want, and the latest fashion is what should be on you at all times. And what Not to Wear does, and what some of these other kind of fashion shows do more, is, you know, how can your clothes sort of express, you know, what you would like to be showing people about yourselves? How can they sort of put the outside, you know, appearance on, you know, you being a dignified person in society? And it's very hard to kind of go against the grain of fashion. You walk into stores, you see, you know, low-cut shirts and low-cut jeans, and you think, oh, that's what I should be wearing now. And sometimes it takes an outside observer. You know, it used to be kind of peer pressure. It used to be other people sort of looking at you and saying, you cannot get away with that. But now people are told, you know, you don't judge another person by what they wear. And so it's almost like you need a fashion expert to be able to give you the excuse to become modest again. And, you know, I think, you know, even in the sense of, you know, how your house should look. I mean, people are just sort of going into stores and they're thinking, oh, I should just buy whatever, you know, is hot right now. And these shows kind of allow them to sort of think about this in a kind of more long-term way, and not just buying on the fly whatever consumer culture is throwing at you. At the top of the bestseller list these days, you will see a lot of chick lit. You'll see Elizabeth Gilbert. You'll see a book called The Help. You'll see The Nanny Diaries, things like that. And you wonder, after you read some of this, particularly the Nanny Diaries series, you know, why we have this obsession with the hired help. I mean, this is 21st century America. Isn't this a democracy? We're all sort of supposed to be egalitarian. And what is the interest in kind of the lives of the people who work for us? And I have to say, I mean, part of this seems to stem from women's discomfort a little bit with their place in society right now. They're not sure who should be raising their children. They're not sure whether they should be staying at home. They're not sure whether they should be working, you know, 80-hour a week jobs just to show that they're the equal of their male peers. You know, they're not sure whether they're helicoptering their children enough. And we have sort of channeled it all into this chick literature and these difficult relationships that women especially have with the women usually who are working for them, whether the nanny is running off with their husband or whether they are having some complete breakdown because they see the way that the help is interacting with their children and they're not sure what to make of that and they're jealous. I mean, there are a lot of intense feelings here. But what is going on here is I think women are, you know, thinking about this form of literature as very kind of, you know, cheesy and something to read on the beach, but it's tapping into some very deep-seated feelings about what the role of a mother is and what are the differences between men and women. And, you know, I think that there are a lot of serious themes in these that people are discounting because they're kind of good beach reads too.